Somebody sent me a thing on YouTube, on a Facebook, a YouTube thing, and it was a video that they did inside of a Marine Corps boot camp barracks. Some of y'all might have seen it, where the drill instructor has got the recruits kind of standing around, and he's doing this little speech to them about what they can expect in boot camp. Have y'all seen that? And, you know, he's real boisterous, and he's really, really loud, you know, and he's gesturing like a, you know, like a drill instructor would kind of do. And he says things like, "We're going to respect you. We're not going to abuse you. We're not going to hit you. We're not going to cuss you. We're going to talk to you like human beings. But it's going to be tough." How many of y'all saw that? And so one of our members said, "Hey, Chuck, does that look familiar?" Kind of like with a big smile. "Does that look familiar?" And I sat there and I thought, that wasn't 1969 boot camp. That's when I went through boot camp, 1969. Because we had a very similar conversation. I mean, our platoon commander had a very similar conversation. I guess they do it in all of them. But basically, our platoon commander said, "Now, if I tell you I'm going to kick you in the gut, I'm going to kick you in the gut." And I did say gut, by the way, G-U-T. Somebody will get that in a minute, okay. "If I tell you I'm going to run your PT until your nose bleeds," physical training. In other words, he said, "If we say we're going to hit you, fight you, bite you, we're going to do that." And you know what? They did exactly what they said. And I thought about that, about this sermon today. Because I'm not going to be, today, I'm not going to be like a 2018 feel-good flower preacher and just tell you all the good stuff. I'm going to tell you what is. I'm going to tell you what God says. Okay? And I want to tell you what, sometimes when God says, "I'm going to kick you in the gut," He kicks you in the gut. I've got a heavy heart about the sermon today. Very heavy heart. Because with the sermon today, we're dealing with eternal consequence. We're dealing with eternal consequence that some will spend an eternity in a lake of fire in eternal torment, not expecting to. Not expecting to. Okay? And I don't want anyone at Cedar Heights Baptist Church to wake up in hell one day not expecting to be there. But there. I kind of feel, Chad, you can relate, a responsibility to preach the truth. Now, we do it in love, but sometimes the truth is kind of painful. Matter of fact, there's a lot of tendency in our culture today to hate the truth, to speak of the truth as though it were hateful. How hateful would it be to withhold the truth so that I would not offend someone, and then for that someone, because I withheld the truth, to wake up in a lake of fire one day crying out, "Why didn't you tell me not to come here for eternity?" That's the kind of sermon I have today. Are you ready to listen? Colossians 1. Stand up if you can, if you would. Verses 21 through 23. Then I'll pray and you can be seated. Paul, writing to the church of Colossae, says, "You were once alienated and hostile in mind because of your evil actions. But now he's reconciled you by his physical body through his death to present you holy, faultless, and blameless before him. If Notice that little word if. Two letters. This little word if has eternal consequence. If, indeed, you remain grounded and steadfast in the faith and are not shifted away from the hope of the gospel that you've heard. This gospel's been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and I, Paul, have become a minister of it. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love. And you know, it's so easy to say, thank you for your love. We love you. Thank you for your love. God, remind us that your love is tempered by the blood of your Son, the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus. And as our passage starts today, we've been changed by that blood as sons and daughters of God. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. And I have to tell you this. I've kind of gloated this past week. I've kind of enjoyed this title I came up with for the sermon today. I've never really put these words together like this. A faith that God believes in. Okay? And so kind of the title this morning is kind of the question of the message. Do you have a faith that God believes in? Because it doesn't matter in the long run, it doesn't matter about what I think about you or anyone else thinks about you and your faith and your walk with God. The question is, does God believe in you, in your faith? That has eternal consequence. Because there's a lot of false faith around. I'm going to speak, or the Word of God is going to speak to that a little bit this morning. So it's a very serious, sobering message. The unregenerate mind, first point, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. This is probably not one of those feel-good sermons, amen? In order to get to the finish line, we've got to start at the beginning point, amen, with God. And the beginning point is to understand that a person without Christ is lost. You know, there's this common misnomer going around, this common generational kind of ridiculous thinking that says, oh, we're all basically good. We're all basically good. Have y'all ever heard that kind of thinking? We're basically good. Biblically speaking, it's one of my favorite Greek words to describe that kind of thinking. The Greek word is baloney. Okay? It's my favorite Greek word, baloney. Because nowhere in the Word of God are you going to find anywhere in the Word of God that God says, without Christ, apart from Christ, oh, we're basically good. That is a lie from hell. Because what that does is that sets you up for eternal destruction. That sets you up to be blasé about your spiritual condition. Oh, you know, well, yeah, I make a few mistakes, but I'm really not that bad a person. You know, I've never killed nobody. It's kind of like old Leroy said down in the bayou. He said, one thing I've never done, I never killed anyone accidentally. Look here. 2:14. 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man does not welcome what comes from God's Spirit because it is foolishness to him. He is not able to know it since it's evaluated spiritually. Then it goes on to talk about the spiritual. There are two kinds of people presented to us in the New Testament. One is the natural person, or if you will, the lost person, the unredeemed person, and then the born-again person, the sons and daughters of God. Those are two different two different spiritual standings before God, and the natural man is the estate of someone that has not yielded to Christ, has not confessed their sin, has not repented of their fallen way of life, their fallen nature. That's the one person, and the other is one that's been born again. Nicodemus in John chapter 3, he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was the upper crust of the Pharisee class. And he comes with a question, what must I do to be born again? He'd heard Jesus talking this stuff to inherit eternal life. And he used the right word there, inherit, because inherit implies family, right? An inheritance. So Jesus responds to the inherit thing, and he says, you've got to be born again. Nicodemus is mystified. How can a man be born again? Can he enter a second time into the womb of his mother? And Jesus says, that which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. You see, there are two births that Christ talks about. The first, that which is born of flesh is flesh. That's the natural norm. We've all been born. Everybody here has been born. You weren't made in a computer. Amen? You were born. You got a mama. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. You must be born again. And I want to tell you what, the rebirth, the born again experience is just as dynamic and real as the being born is dynamic. We had a new baby in our church the other day. Amen. Matt. Had little Luke Bowers. Luke Matthew Bowers was born the other day. Luke, Matt's here. Is Luke here? Still at home? Beautiful. And I sit there at the hospital and holding this. Every time I hold a newborn baby, it freaks me out. Looking at this miracle of organization, this miracle. And every time I hold one of these babies, I thank God I wasn't the mother. Somebody say amen. All you men say amen. All right. Cowards. Okay. And I know that mother that delivered that baby went through quite a traumatic event delivering that baby. Amen, moms? I mean, I was there when John was born and Emily was, we did Lamaze, and you know, I did the whole breathe, push thing, breathe, push. And I'm convinced it's a lot harder on the men than the women. Yeah. I want to tell you what, I know, now Joel got there before I got to the hospital. That's why I left Joel out. I really think as that mother's in that the birthing process, I think they're right on the cusp of death. I really believe that. I think they're as close as anyone can come to dying and not dying is in that moment when that birth is delivered. I've seen a lot of trauma, let me tell you. I saw trauma in Vietnam. But I don't think I've ever witnessed the kind of trauma I've seen in my wife with the first two of our children born. Just as surely as there's a lot of trauma in that natural birth, I want to tell you what, there's a great more trauma in the second birth to be born again. It cost Jesus life. It's nothing to be taken lightly. So kind of going from this unregenerate mind into the next point about being reconciled. Look at 1 Peter 3:18. In Colossians, Paul says we've been reconciled. Look at 1 Peter 3:18. I want to focus on that for just a minute. What did it take for us to be reconciled? Okay. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also suffered for sins. You know, it's so easy for us to read that. No, he suffered for sins. Do we have any earthly idea what in the world we're saying when we say he suffered for sins? Once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring you to God. And after being put to death in the fleshly realm, he was made alive, but made alive in the spiritual realm. And he goes on. Have you been born again? And just, I've tried to kind of highlight how much stressful it is for that natural birth. But let me tell you what, it doesn't begin to compare of the kind of agony it took to be reborn again. Christ on the cross. You know, when I think about church life, you know, I've heard the old preachers put it this way. Faith that falters at the last was faulty from the first. We're living in a time in the United States of America. Now, this is not true worldwide. Because in the vast majority of the world, Christians are following Christ under a lot of pressure, persecution. And in those areas, there are great movements of God taking place. It's really amazing what's going on. But in the United States of America, we have a whole different spiritual reality here. I think I would call it the crisis of prosperity. That's what it's been called. And it's really, as far as things go, it's probably the greatest crisis that ever faces a culture is prosperity. And then to be Christians inside of a prosperous culture is very dangerous. Because what it does, it attracts, there's an attraction. It can attract people to the church who are not really born again. It looks inviting. Maybe their friends go there. Maybe they're just kind of lonely and need some good fellowship, want to get in a good fellowship group, things like that. Or maybe they've made a few kind of bad mistakes in their life, you know, they've gotten into some kind of trouble, and they just sit there and think, well, you know, I need a change. I think I'll try church. I think I'll try going to church. I got some friends. I know some folks over there. That seems like a good church. I think I'll give that a try. And so I'll never forget when Mary and I were dating. Across the street from Mary lived two one was a widow, one had never been married. Two sisters lived together. And one of them worked at the Baptist bookstore back in those days before it was known as Lifeway. And she was the old maid. She had never been married. I mean, she was married. Her husband had been a Baptist preacher. And I always loved to talk, and her name was Mary also. And I always loved to talk to her because every time I would talk to her, it was like God would say, have something to say to me through her, through this old Baptist preacher widow. And so we were on Mary's driveway there at her house, and Miss Mary saw me, and she came over to, you know, we were having some nice, light conversation. And I could always tell when it was the Spirit of God getting ready to say something. Because it happened right there. All of a sudden her demeanor changed, and she got this serious, solemn look on her face. And she said, you know, Charlie, she said, there's something starting to worry me. My ears perked up. What's that, Miss Mary? What's bothering you? Well, you know, Brother Charlie said, when Joe, her husband's name had been Joe, when Joe would preach, she said people would get convicted of sin, and they would be moved. And she said, Charlie, they would come to the altar and they would kneel in the altar and they would cry out to God and they would weep over their lives, they would weep over their sin, and they would pray and they would ask God, they would beg God for forgiveness. And she said God would forgive them. And she said, and when they stood up, they were new people. And she was a member of a nice church in Little Rock this time. And she said, you know, she said, now then our preacher preaches and he preaches a nice sermon. And she said, he gives the invitation, said, she said, people will walk down the aisle and they'll take him by the hand and they'll shake his hand and they'll come and they'll, quote, join our church. Or she said, but they're the same people. She said, it's really bothering me. I'll never forget that. Miss Mary, it's bothering me. And I thought, yeah, well, you remember those days when people used to grieve over their sinful lives? But now then, this idea in our culture, oh, we're all basically, you know, good people. And now then, what we're seeing is a falling away from the church. Are y'all aware of that? There's a falling away going on. I want to illustrate it with a few verses. Turn to 1 John chapter 2. A little 1st, 2nd, 3rd John toward the end, you know, 1 John chapter 2. John speaks of this here in 1 John chapter 2, verse number 19. Well, we could start at verse 18. Amanda really doesn't like it when I do that. Children, 1 John 2:18, children, it's the last hour. And as you've heard, now he said this 2,000 years ago, okay? It's the last hour, and as you've heard, Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come. We know from this that it's the last hour. Verse 19, look at this. They went out from us, but they did not belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. However, they went out so that it might be made clear that none of them belongs to us. Y'all, have you ever heard of the doctrine of the perseverance of the saints? Those that are born again will persevere. At least that's kind of what John's saying here, isn't it? They went out, they walked away. They walked away. Matthew chapter 25. Matthew 25. Matthew 25 and 26, those two chapters comprise what we call the Olivet Discourse. It's a discourse, it's a pretty sobering, somber discourse Christ has with his disciples right before he goes to die. Okay? And 25, chapter 25. You're familiar with the sheep and the goats, starting at verse 31, the sheep and the goats. Sheep on the right hand, the goats on the left hand. I was sick, I was hungry. Verse 37, the righteous answered, Lord, when did we see you? When you done unto the least of these, you done unto me. Verse 42, the goats, those that he throws away. Verse 44, they too will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry, thirsty, stranger, naked, without clothes, sick, prison, not help you? And he said, I assure you, whenever you didn't do it for the least of these, you didn't do it for me. Verse 46, sounds serious to me. They'll go away into eternal punishment, and the righteous to eternal life. The thing is, and Jesus addresses this more than just here, the thing is, they fully expected to go to heaven. Fully expected. Look at John, Gospel of John chapter 6. John chapter 6. So guess what I'm really saying here is, have you been regenerated? Have you been born again? I'm not talking about did you just come to church because you felt like you needed a change. John chapter 6. Now before we get to chapter 6, Jesus is doing some great stuff. He's raising the dead, healing the sick. Here at the first of chapter 6, he's feeding the multitudes with a couple of fish and loaves of bread. And he's got multitudes following him around, okay? He's got thousands and thousands of people that are following him everywhere he goes. They are there for the goodies. They're amazed at what he's doing. They're amazed at the show, okay? So Jesus then kind of says, okay, come here, let's have a little talk. He kind of does what our drill instructor, since I mentioned boot camp, we, after about the third day of basic training, right before we go to bed that night, drill instructor called us in. We're outside. He says, come gather around me. And we're all freaked out because he's talking, not screaming. Okay, I want to talk to you. If, you know, we've had these first 3 days, and if you don't think you can make it, if you'll just stand up, we'll send you back to your home, no questions asked, if you don't think you can make it the next 12, 13 weeks. Or if you don't think you can kill somebody. So a guy from Pine Bluff, Arkansas, stood up. Drill instructor called him forward. I won't say his name. Private? Is it you don't think you can make it, or you don't think you can kill somebody? And Private said, I don't think I can kill anybody, sir. So our drill instructor started thrashing. I'm not exaggerating. He led into the private, and I won't describe how graphic it was. And then when he got through, he picked him up by the right here, so the guy's feet are about 6 inches off the ground, and the guy's face is right here, and he screams, Private so-and-so, do you think you can kill me right now? And Private so-and-so said, sir, yes, sir! And he threw him back into this pile of us, and he said, anybody else don't think you can kill someone? We said, we want to go kill somebody. Jesus kind of does this kind of a moment here. They've been there for the goodies, okay? The miracles and the healings and the feeding and the food and all that. Oh, yeah. And now then he says, okay, you've seen the big show. You've seen all the goodies. Now here's what it's going to take to follow me. You got to eat my flesh and drink my blood. Whew. And so in verse number 40 there, they go, whew, this is a hard saying. Who can do it? Now, they knew he wasn't talking about ripping stuff off of his skin and draining blood. They knew what he meant was, you're going to have to live the life I'm living. You're going to have to follow my life. Look at verse 66. You got 66. Look at, underline verse 66. From that time, what's it call them? Disciples. From that time, many of his disciples, depending on your translation, departed from him, and what? They walked away. Walked no more with him. Now, granted, they hadn't been born again because being born again wasn't available yet. Jesus hadn't died on the cross. But what I'm saying is there are a lot of folks that are all into this church stuff for the goodies, for the flash, for the show, for the glitter and the glitz, amen? Or for the fellowship, for the good times, for the support, for the encouragement. Yeah, all good things, right? Except, what about this thing about following Jesus? Have you been born again? Have you been washed in the blood of the Lamb? I remember I was preaching revival 40 years ago over in West Arkansas. I think I've shared this before. Kind of worth. The preacher and I were out visiting one day. And we went to this little apartment thing. It's real, just a two-story thing. Had front rail, you know, walkway. It was kind of like a motel, cheap motel, kind of. And about 5 apartments on top, about 10 little apartments. And we were on the second level and knocked on the door, and the guy opened the door, and he was shocked to see us there. He was a member of the Jehovah's Witness. And you know, they often knock on doors, and now we were knocking on his door. We didn't know who he was or anything. Anyway, we started sharing with him, and he shared with us, well, I'm a member of Jehovah's Witness. I'm not knocking Jehovah's Witness per se. This happens to be the story, true story. And so as we were talking and he was defending his position, I said, well, I want to just ask you a question. I said, can you look me in the eye and say to me, looking me in the eye, Jesus is my Lord? Well, he kind of hesitated a little bit, and yeah, I could do that, he says. I said, I don't think you can. And go ahead, just look me in the eye and say, Jesus is my Lord. I could do it, I could do it. I wouldn't even have to mean it. I could, no, go do it. Go, come on, I mean, I wouldn't be an ugly, just do it. And so he looks me in the eye, we're standing there, you know, face to face, and he says, Jesus is, and he started like hyperventilating, started gasping. He literally collapsed at the preacher's and my, literally fell out right in front of us, gasping for air. I'll never forget that. And when I made sure he wasn't going to, you know, die, I told him as we were leaving, I said, until you can make that confession, one day you will die and wake up in a hell you don't even believe in forever. And the preacher and I, we went and got in the preacher's car, and immediately, without prompting each other, it was kind of a heavy moment, you know. And we looked at each other, and without any prompting, we looked at each other, and we both said, Jesus is my Lord. Woo, it was a relief to say it, amen. I want to ask you a question this morning. Can you look me in the eye? Can you look us in the eye? And can you truthfully, from the bottom of your heart, say, Jesus is my Lord? I'm going to count to three. Okay? And I want you to look me in the eye. I don't have 150 eyes, but don't look down, because he tried that once. He said, Jesus, he mumbled something. I said, no, you got to look me in the eye. So you, everybody look right here and think about this, what you're getting ready to say. Jesus is my Lord. Okay, on the count of three. One, two, three. Does that feel kind of free to say that? If you will confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you'll what? You will be saved. Okay? If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Listen, there is nothing in this life worth hanging on to that's worth rejecting that truth. Nothing. One guy had it all. He had listened to the popular preaching of his day. He had been successful, had to build bigger barns. Jesus looked at him and called him a fool. And that night he woke up where? In hell. And from hell he lifted his eyes. Father Abraham, have mercy. Send that old leper with one drop of water from my tongue. Have mercy. Oh, in the eyes of the world, he had it all together. Not in the eyes of God. Song of Solomon, chapter 1. Do you have a living faith? Okay. Do you have a faith God believes in? I'm not trying to preach, save people into making decisions, but I do want to tell the truth. Because there's a lot of misinformation out here. And this very simple verse here, I guess I would say it like this. It's easy to say, but could we say, like with the woman here in Song of Songs 1:7, tell me, you, the one I love, where do you pasture? Do you really love Christ? Do we really love Christ? You know, I do love my wife. And you know, how much love do you think I'd have for my wife if I went around denying she was my wife? Or ashamed that she's my wife? Would you call that love? Let's bow for prayer. Jennifer, y'all come get ready for an invitation. I'm not passing judgment on anyone. Chad and I are here at the front. I'm not trying to talk anyone into being lost. Do you have biblical faith? Have you been born again? Or is your Christianity a matter of convenience? I'm going to tell you, if it's a matter of convenience, you're going to walk away one day. You will. Father, we come before you this morning in the name of our Lord Jesus. We thank you for your love for us. And again, we acknowledge that saying a lot, your love that was demonstrated. Not with spoken words, but you sent your only son to die. So we could be born again. A new heart, a new mind, a new spirit. Transformed, changed. Not the same. Ever. Born again. We owe you everything. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's